Hey, it's Azure Friday. I'm talking with Erich Gamma, a distinguished engineer. How are you, sir?
Pretty good.
You built something cool.
I like what I built. That's
all
true.
Right.
That's true.
Let's talk about it. What am I looking at here?
So here you see a website. You spot the URL and you see it's on Azure.
Okay. This looks like I can turn lights off at someone's house.
It's actually the house of our PM, so don't overdo it, right?
Okay.
It's live.
Yeah.
Okay, what we also have, okay, that's the website and the portal. And the magic new thing is now you can have this link here added in Visual Studio Online.
Okay.
And if you do that, you look behind the cover, right? You open the kimono and you see the source code behind the website.
So you're live editing a deployed website in production?
No, okay, that's one way to use it. But typically what you do is you create a development website, you load the code in there,
right,
and that's you do the work, right? Because you don't want to do the thrill seeking, right?
Would hope not.
So I didn't show that, but that's what we typically do. We just load the code from source control, from Git, into the website.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can use the website to run it, test it, and you develop all in the website. If you want to see your changes, all you do is refresh the page. So why don't you make a change now?
Okay.
So this thing has some chat, of course. Our PM loves to chat with his house. Let's just wait till.
That's actually a good idea. You could have you can actually send commands to it, and the
right.
house will chat back at you.
So hi, you know, the me is in red, hi is in red. Let's just change something. Make a change that's ugly enough that you can spot it, right?
Yeah.
So let's go in here. That's the app. It's a Node app, which has some JavaScript, jQuery-based UI. Okay, let's just go to chat.js.
So you're moving around just like I expect to move around in Visual Studio. You can.
Yeah, it's the goal is really you want to build something very lightweight.
It's
right?
Light. It's Visual Studio light.
It's very light, fully responsive, and gives you still the comfort of coding, right? We
okay.
we want to code it comfort. No matter where we code it, we want to code it comfort.
So
let's make a small change, like add some CSS, right? So the chat message, when you append the message, we also want to do some background color, right? And you see I get IntelliSense.
Okay.
And even parameter hints.
This editor looks very familiar to me.
I've
seen this before.
I hope so. It's not our first coming out, right? We have gradually expanded, dropped out of the bottle, right? So
mm-hmm.
we have different components to build online stuff, and this is now what you see here is where you see most of what we have. So this shows you an editor, an explorer. It shows you source control integration and a console where you can do real development.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of. We have different configurations, and the smallest configuration is just the editor, which you see on SkyDrive.
Inside of the mobile
services.
Right. So that's the most basic. It's
yeah.
the here's a div, make it an editor, and it's got language services and all that behind it.
Right.
But this looks kind of like the TFS.Visual Studio user interface, where I can have my build and my test and all the different things that are my entire application lifecycle.
Right. We integrate with that, of course, right? So we have a Git integration, so we'll show that. So I made a change. Let's go to to the Git integration. So I can actually connect. Okay, have permission denied. Let's just.
Because we're on a test. You get
sure. And now it doesn't really like me.
Well, you're on a test
sure.
stamp here.
Oh, that's the problem. Yeah.
Do you know your password? That's the question.
Yeah, I wonder now which one I am. Okay. Baby, go away.
Okay.
So I didn't initialize the Git repository. Let's do that.
So this is interesting because in Antarius, which is the code name for Azure websites,
right.
they use Git as their kind of holding place to receive deployments and
right.
to stage
right.
deployments. You have your own repository for doing your editing.
Yes, developer. The thing is, no, CUDA is really used for deployment, for Git as a deployment vehicle. Right, and we have an alternative. Rather than deploy through Git, you can edit directly with us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a little bit competing, right? So you have to decide either you want to use CUDA for deployment or you want to direct edit your
right.
website. If you direct edit your website, you have to know what you do because
mm-hmm.
the changes you push from CUDA will override your changes
right.
over there. Right.
But if you set up things like you said, dev and staging and production, you could edit in dev
exactly.
and commit and then push.
That's
over
exactly
to CUDA,
how
which
we
would
recommend.
Then bounce to production.
That's exactly how we recommend to do it, right? Use CUDA for deployment. If you edit, then just let CUDA on the side
mm-hmm.
in your development website.
Now, would this be something that I would plan on using every day and all day, or would I use it for sites of a certain size or specific kinds of changes where I don't have all of Visual Studio?
So we have different scenarios, right? One is kind of, no, you sit at your model's place and you got on Hacker News and cool, everybody talks on your website and they see you have a bug in your website, right? But
right.
you don't have Visual Studio, of course. You can exit from any browser, do the fix there, and be happy and be cozy. For other scenarios, like if you want to do an ASP.NET app, then I would say you make small tweaks in there because Visual Studio is just the best environment to do ASP.NET, right? That's just given C-sharp IntelliSense. And we don't have C-sharp IntelliSense. We have textual autocomplete, mm-hmm. which we know is a big difference, right? But what you saw here for JavaScript, we offer you IntelliSense.
What this kind of reminds me of, and I'm speaking as a user because this is the first time that I've seen this, is
right.
You know how there's Office 365, which has the word web app and the word Excel app, and they've seen the Excel app, rather, and they're all written in JavaScript, and they're 50-60% of Word and 50-60% of Excel. But then when you want to do really serious work, then you bring down Excel or Word. So it's a complementary application.
It's in the similar spirit, complementary, but I think for some scenarios, right, for instance, we are aggressive dog fooders.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and we try to develop whatever we can day in, day out with our stuff.
Ah.
So we can do that, right?
So you're writing your stuff with your own stuff?
We're writing your stuff with our own stuff.
Wow.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's see what it got to have ugly red, right? Proof, right? That all the data was just refreshing the website.
Wow.
So that's how it works, right? There are some other interesting things behind it. It's JavaScript, but actually we use lots of the power of TypeScript here. So TypeScript now will compiler with type inference, whatever. Mm-hmm. So it's still JavaScript. Let me show you something, how this shows up. When I do now name.
We are in a JavaScript .js file, right?
.js file, right? Okay. But we don't use JSLint or JSHint. We use TypeScript to validate that code.
So TypeScript is your compilation step.
Yes.
Linting.
Exactly. And you see now it tells me, because I assigned a string to it, hey, it's a warning. Of course, in TypeScript it would be an error, but in JavaScript it give you a warning.
Right, because you could keep going if you wanted to. You could ignore that.
Exactly. Also, what I can also do, you know, I want, when I forget that I'm in JavaScript, right, and I add things like, oh, that's a string. Oops. Sorry, didn't mean that.
No, but this is good because it's giving you, you're made of an error, and it's giving you hints for why there's a problem.
Yes, I just want to show you some more interesting error.
No, of
course. Let's see, I had a message here.
And this isn't forcing people to use TypeScript, but that's, like, as you said, this is your linting tool that you're using.
Yes, it's actually more than that. Okay, so that's my linting tool. If I forget that I'm JavaScript, then we even tell you, hey, you typed in TypeScript here, right? So TypeScript is kind of now cooperative. They annotate AST with the notes which are TypeScript specific.
So you didn't opt in to TypeScript in this case, so it's saying to
exactly.
you,
don't forget, it's cool, but it's not here. The IntelliSense here is interesting, right? We had this IntelliSense I showed mm-hmm. you, the CSS. And what's behind the scene is also TypeScript again. And if you look behind the covers, you see we have these triple slash references, which you often do in Visual Studio. But our triple slash references refers to a .t.ts file.
What is the term? What is the word you're saying? The triple what?
Triple slash reference.
Oh, okay. Oh, so the // reference. So this is the annotation that's hinting to JavaScript. Your type system information for JavaScript.
Exactly. Or another file you want to reference, right? Because that you find out if you work in multiple files and the cross-file dependencies. But what's different with us here, we just say we reference a .t.ts file.
Okay.
And TypeScript is great to describe JavaScript libraries, right? And you want to leverage that even when you do JavaScript, you want to give it the benefit of people having typed JavaScript libraries.
Right.
And if you go to GitHub, you see there's a whole project called Definitely Typed, where people can generate TypeScript typings for all kind of libraries, Angular, Knockout, what have you.
So what is the D in this context? Is it it's definitely
definition.
Typed?
Definition.
So it's a definition
file.
So that's not jQuery proper, which jQuery exists there. It's jQuery, you've got 1.83 there.
Exactly.
This is so just the...
This is the typings in TypeScript now, which describe using lots of these interfaces techniques you can use in TypeScript to describe these The option bags, yeah. The types, the functions.
It's the IDL, it's the WSDL, it's the type
definition.
But
it's a very
file.
Powerful WSDL, right? Because it's also you can also use our tool to check it, right? It's TypeScript, and you can edit it, and it's much more pleasant than doing some WSDL or XML.
So if I were to write one of these .d.tss for my own company's JavaScript, it wouldn't be hard because
no,
I would have
hard, no?
I would have TypeScript all the way through to do it.
Yes, yes. And once you do that, you get typings, and behind the scenes, we then give this to the TypeScript language service, how we call it, which is also written in TypeScript, transpiled to JavaScript, so we can run it in the browser. We give that, and that's how we get the completions.
Very cool. Let's dig into that in the next video.
Okay.
Thanks. It's Azure Friday. Thank you.